Hello and welcome to Hazard and Hope. I'm Ed, and in this episode we're going to be looking at how to design and adapt a property to be more flood recoverable. So here we go. This episode of Hazard and Hope is sponsored by Yorkshire Flood Resilience. So first and foremost, what do we mean by flood recoverability and why is it needed? Well, essentially making a property flood recoverable will mean that if or when flood water comes inside the building, there's minimal loss, damage and disruption to the actual building's fabric and its contents. And flood recoverability is one of a range of approaches within the remit of property flood resilience, also known as PFR. A key piece of guidance in this area is the Code of Practice for Property Flood Resilience. We've put a link for this in the description just below this video, but if you'd like to find out more about it, you can also check out the overview video that we've made just here. And it essentially sets out the key process and standards through which to undertake PFR in both new build and existing contexts. Now in this episode, we're going to be looking at flood recoverable approaches, but we have also made an episode on flood resistance measures, the aim of which is to help restrict water entry into a building. So for example, that can include things like flood doors. We're also making an episode on avoidance-based approaches for PFR, and that includes things like raising floor levels, changing the location of habitable areas, or even adjusting the vertical or horizontal position of the building itself. But back to flood recoverability. Now, the Code of Practice defines it as the use of materials, products, and construction methods that prevent the internal fabric of the property from being unduly damaged by flood water and allow it to recover quickly after a flooding. So that could mean changing the wall or floor finishes so that they're materials which won't swell or distort when in contact with flood water. It's also often referred to as recoverable repair, resilient reinstatement, resilient repair, or even wetproofing. So why would you need or choose to make a property flood recoverable? Well, we can see in these images the catastrophic damage that flood water can cause. Materials swelling, absorbing and distorting on contact with flood water, losing their structural integrity and needing to be ripped or dried out and reinstated, and it can take significant cost and time to do so. And as you can see here, there are many different ways in which flood water can enter a property. It doesn't just have to come in through the front door, it can seep in through party walls, surcharge through drainage systems and rise up from beneath the building. And if the building's fabric and its contents are not flood recoverable, then there can be a vast amount of damage caused. So I suppose the next thing to consider is in which contexts a flood recoverable approach could be considered and what are the benefits? Well, it could be that the flood hazard assessment and the property survey actually reveal that resistance-based approaches such as flood doors aren't actually suited on the building. So it may be inadvisable to attempt to exclude water entry, and that can be the case for many historic properties. It may also be that long durations of floods are actually expected, where resistance-based methods may not be able to keep water out for those extended periods of time, or there could be significant leakage over that time, and so you need to think about how you'd cope and make the interior flood recoverable. It could also be that you're in a context where flash flooding occurs, and there might not actually be enough time to fit and install those resistance measures in place. Or it might actually be that the resistance measures you have in place are overtopped or breached. And so if that flood water does come inside and enter the building, it can make a lot of sense for the interior to be flood recoverable so that there's minimal damage. And I suppose given that significant hydrostatic and hydrodynamic loads can build up around flood resistance measures when we're keeping water out, it can be advisable to actually let the water in to relieve that structural loading, and that's often termed deliberate water entry. And lastly, a recoverable approach may well be incorporated as part of an integrated approach to property flood resilience, where actually flood resistance measures are used to keep water out, but up to a particular depth. And then when actually the water exceeds those levels, that it comes inside the building and the actual interior is flood recoverable. So you have a diverse range of different strategies in place. And the benefits of this flood recoverable approach are really that it can significantly speed up recovery times and can also reduce the cost of repair. So you might see fewer expensive or precious items and materials being damaged. You may also not have to actually leave your property or relocate post-flood for as long or even at all. And with this recoverable approach, I would say that there can also be a lot less stress and uncertainty in knowing that the building and its fabrics will be okay if and when a flood occurs, because you've planned and designed in advance for it to be recoverable and for the presence of water to be there. And it can be a lot easier and quicker to dry a building if it's been made flood recoverable. But there is also the potential that it could help to reduce your insurance premiums. And I suppose that's part of the movement towards what we're seeing with insurers rewarding resilience. And I mean, we can see actually in Claire's house in her episode of Our Flood Resilient Home that they've really designed and adapted it to do everything they can to make sure that if or when a flood were to occur, that it has minimal impact to their building and to their lives. Now, I'm not going to go through every single way that we can make a property flood recoverable. We are going to be making more detailed episodes on particular approaches, but as an overview, we're going to look at a range of elements. So let's start with the floors. And if it's a suspended timber floor and water rises up from beneath the building, then that floodwater can obviously enter and damage the property if it's not flood recoverable. Now, you can of course use resistance measures such as automatic air bricks to actually stop water getting into that underfloor zone, but you can also use sump and pump systems to keep the water at a low level in that underfloor void and actually buy you some time. Now, the floorboards themselves can be hardwood rather than softwood, or even braced so that they don't actually swell or distort when drying. Or it might be that you actually change the floor build up itself from a suspended timber floor to a solid floor type. So you'd actually take away that underfloor void and remove a potential point and route of floodwater entry into the building. Now, something like a solid concrete floor, you do need to consider how things like the floor screed, insulation, and the floor finishes can be made flood recoverable. You can, for example, specify flood resilient types of screed that actually dry quicker. And when it comes to insulation, for parts of the building that could come into contact with flood water, it can make sense to use closed cell insulation types so that they'd be less water absorbed and they're easier to dry out. Now, floor coverings like carpets can often be what we see filling up many of the skips outside flood damaged homes. But there are ways that we can actually specify more flood recoverable floor coverings. You could design the carpet to be more easily rolled up pre-flood and have even furniture that's easy to lift and move out of the way. But that can, of course, take time. I mean, it could actually be that you just have rugs in the middle of a solid floor and you can just roll them up out of the way, or that you specify a tiled, stone or composite flooring with waterproof grouts on joints. Now, when it comes to walls and wall linings, you can use tanking systems and membranes to actually help limit the transference of water through the fabric of the building. And these can direct water towards channels around the perimeter of rooms and off to the pump and sump systems and out of the building. But when flood water comes in contact with cement-based plasters, it can saturate it, and material may need to be chipped off to avoid damp, mold and even rot. Now, bear in mind that removal can be noisy, messy and quite an invasive process. A more recoverable approach is to actually use lime and cement-based plasters, and these can actually often dry out naturally and may not need to be removed from the wall itself. And it can also be that you even add water-resistant adhesives to the surface, which can help to limit the movement of salts through the material. When it comes to something like plasterboard, I mean, it only takes a tiny bit of flood water to touch the bottom corner of the board for it to soak up, get soggy, swell and distort, and ultimately need to be ripped off and removed and reinstated. But there actually are types of flood resilient plasterboard, and these are typically more water compatible and won't necessarily need to be removed post flood. It can also be that you actually choose to install the plasterboards in a horizontal rather than a vertical orientation, so that the parts of the room which are at higher flood risk actually covered with resilient plasterboard at low level horizontally, and that the higher levels are specified with more standard boards. Now, let's look at the electrics within a building. I mean, these can be very badly damaged by flood water and require often a lot of work to rip out and reinstate them. So in terms of things you could do to make them and the property more flood recoverable, you can raise the sockets themselves and actually have their wiring fed from the ceiling down. You can also move things like fuse boxes higher and fit electrical items like TVs on the wall so that they're not knocked off tables if and when that flood occurs. I mean, it might also be that you choose to split the electrical circuits so that the ground floor or area exposed to flood water can be turned off and isolated. That means that you may be able to keep your lights on and heating on, power on upstairs, and have less disruption and speed up the recovery time. Now let's look at the kitchen. And really, many of those white goods and soggy kitchen cabinets are the items that we see being ripped out of flood damaged homes. And so there's a huge amount of damage and disruption that can be caused when a kitchen floods. Now, for the first thing to point out is obviously that there are so many different styles and types of kitchen out there. And so it really, when we're thinking about flood recoverable approaches there's so many different options to consider and ways in which you may choose to make your own kitchen flood recoverable. And if we look at Lisa's kitchen in the blue teapot, it's stainless steel, whilst in Claire's house we can see here a flood recoverable solid wood kitchen. And I suppose if we look at the different overlaps in these approaches, you know, they've both tried to put a lot of storage at higher level. And they wanted the materials of the kitchens to be as water compatible as possible and for things to be flexible and actually how they could be adapted in the event of a flood. The kitchen cabinets themselves can also be made of composite materials. An example of that is at the BRE's Flood Repairable Home. Now, when it comes to things like white goods and electrical products within the kitchen, we actually saw at Claire's house that, you know, she unplugs her washing machine and has it up on trellises to put it out of harm's way. And her cooker also has stainless steel legs. And we saw in Sue's episode of Our Flood Resilient Home, you know, her cooker is up at higher level. And Lisa in the cafe obviously has some very large, expensive fridges. And so actually, you know, needs to move these to higher grounds if and when she gets a flood warning. Now, the materiality and type of furniture with a property is a key thing to consider when it comes to flood recoverability. You might look to specify or use items that can be foldable, light and easy to move, or ones with solid legs or made with materials that are much more water compatible. And as we saw in Claire's house, you know, her and her family put their sofa up on that big wooden dining table they've got. And if we look at Sue's house, you know, she gets those bricks from outside her back door and piles them up and raises up her piano to get it out of harm's way. But really, you know, you don't want items to be difficult or time consuming to move. So things like the bookshelves could well be actually fixed high up on the wall and out of harm's way, or it's set up so they're actually quick to empty and relocate in the event of a flood. When it comes to the recoverability of possessions and contents within a property, of course, it's best to store these in a low risk part of the building or in a location that will not be affected by flooding. But having backups and duplicates can be extremely important. You know, for something like a business, for example, you know, backing up that data can be absolutely vital for business continuity, and you know, it needs to be in multiple places. You need to know that that's safe if and when a flood occurs. Now, that's an overview of just some of the approaches, and there's obviously many more out there, but if we now look at actually how you would specify a recoverable approach, first and foremost, the suitability and selection depends, of course, on the particular flood risk context, the property setup, its function, and the user preferences. And the code of practice sets out the steps and stages to follow in that regard. So first of all, any design process should consider the sources of flooding and the pathways by which it reaches the property. Then understanding the potential frequency and severity of flood events can really help inform the actual flood recoverable measures that could be specified. A key factor to consider is, of course, what the building is actually made of and whether the existing or proposed building will be actually suited for flood recoverable approaches and how it may need to be adapted. You do also need to consider actually how people will live in that space, you know, how they could evacuate the property and the way in which it would be dried or decontaminated if a flood did occur. And with something like a historic building, for example, you know, it can take longer to dry out plaster just so that it doesn't actually crack or dry out too much. And so we really do need to be specific about the way in which particular materials and the building fabric is recovered. And the thresholds of particular flood resistance measures are obviously crucial to identify and need to inform and relate to the way in which the building's fabric and finishes have been made flood recoverable. Yeah, many properties will also have had extensions and alterations made to them over time, and these can be weak points which could potentially undermine any flood recoverable approach. But underlying all of these recoverable approaches, you know, we need to consider the potential floodwater routes and actually how it could be removed from a property. And pump and sump systems can be particularly effective for this. And it's important to remember, of course, that even when resistance measures are working, there can be a degree of leakage. And we saw this in Sue's episode of Our Flood Resilient Home, and her floodboards and non-return valves helped to slow down that floodwater entry into her home. But water did seep in, and they were able to actually just mop it across their stone floor towards that drainage outlet and the sump and pump. Now, the selection of any approach will, of course, depend on how people would actually like to live in and use that space. But of course, it will be influenced by the budget and resources that are available. Now, a couple of disclaimers about this approach. Making a property flood recoverable does not mean that it will be completely unaffected by flood water or will be entirely back to its former condition post flood. The building's fabric and its contents can still require cleaning, decontamination, and redecoration. When we think about what makes up floodwater, there can be some really nasty contaminants that are caught up within that mix. And so, you know, it's not always just a case of hosing it down and back to business again. You know, it can require appropriate cleaning and decontamination. And excessive depths and durations of floodwater can eventually cause materials to fail or thresholds to be exceeded. You know, and it's not necessarily going to be suited for every construction type or flood risk context. And the performance of any measure will, of course, be reliant on them being correctly specified, installed, and managed and maintained over time. During the construction and commissioning phase, the code of practice sets out a number of steps and checks to ensure that measures have been correctly installed. And awareness of the PFR measures that have been used needs to be enduring, as you can imagine that if a property was to be sold and somebody bought it, they need to understand actually why particular materials and measures have been specified and put in place. So there's not a risk that they're actually going to be ripped out incorrectly or removed, and that their performance won't be impaired by any alterations. So as the code of practice sets out, a handover pack is needed to pass on this appropriate information about how and why the property has been set up to be flood resilient and flood recoverable. But it's not just the bricks and mortar that will need to be adapted. I mean, any successful PFR setup will need to be operated and maintained in the right way. And the actual hierarchy and interconnectedness of measures does need to be clearly communicated to people who actually use the building and documented, so that if a flood did occur, the property is managed and maintained in the right way. Whichever recoverable approach you choose to use or specify, it needs to be linked into the flood recovery plan. And this plan needs to do a number of things. So it needs to identify the potential routes of water entry and set out which PFR measures are in place. It should make clear the actions people should take before and during a flood. So that could be lifting items on trellises or fitting resistance measures such as deployable flood barriers. And it needs to set out actually what actions and measures are to take place after the flood. So that really relates to things like how flood water will be safely removed and the plan for how things will be dried and reinstated. And that includes checking to ensure that materials haven't been compromised and where certain improvements can be made. Now, a lot of this episode has obviously been around the idea of retrofitting or upgrading these flood recoverable measures onto an existing building, but these can of course be specified and fitted onto new build properties. I mean, it may be that flood recoverability is not needed for years to come, but actually as the frequency and severity of flood events increases as a result of climate change, if the properties can be flood resilient just in case, then I think that's a really good thing. So if you think that you'd like to make your property more flood recoverable, then what's the next step? Well, the code of practice shows us the process that we need to go through. And really the first step is to get advice from a suitable professional on the flood hazard and your property setup, so that they can actually help to review which options may be suitable for your given context and your particular preferences. And from there, you can work up a site-specific and contextual strategy that suits you and the way in which you want to live in and use that space. So thanks very much for listening. And if you'd like to keep updated on future episodes, please subscribe below, hit the bell for notifications, and we look forward to seeing you soon.